es Billy Jamie. Information for transformation.
Shout hallelujah. And louder hallelujah. The Lord God bless you. To the heavens and declare this with holy violence. My Father, my Father, my Father, Allah, His grace, my Goliath, in the name of Jesus, my Father, my Father, my Father, Allah. Disgrace my Goliath. Masetheke aboshentera basandia. In Jesus' name we pray. Some people here need to pray this next prayer with powerful violence. Anywhere my name is mentioned in darkness, can you shout this loud? Fire of God, scatter them in the name of Jesus. Open your mouth and decree it. Anywhere my name is mentioned in darkness, and the fire of the God of Elijah scatter them in the name of Jesus. In Jesus' name we pray. I plug my life into the sockets of divine favor by the power in the blood of Jesus. Open your mouth and plug your life into the sockets of divine favor. By the power in the blood of Jesus. I plug my life into the socket of divine favor. In Jesus' name we pray. A louder amen. Now with a very loud voice, a voice louder than anyone around you, sing this prophetic song loud and clear.
Unto thee, O Lord, do I
shout, sing it again, loud and clear.
Unto thee, O Lord, God is by your side and his power is touching you. I decree upon the life of someone here that the fire of God, as of the days of Elijah, shall descend and fight your battles. In the name of Jesus. And you, that person over there, those powers that have conspired together to scatter your resources, shall dry up in the name of Jesus. And you, that person over there too, the powers that are gathering themselves together like the mighty sea to suppress your elevation, shall disgrace themselves. In the name of Jesus. And you, that person over there, you are here this morning looking so worried. But this prayer and this prophecy is for you, that every satanic panel set up against you shall scatter unto desolation. In the name of Jesus. And upon the life of 21 persons here, the rod of the wicked assigned to punish you shall punish the owner, 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 shall punish the owner. In the name of Jesus. Lay your hands upon your head. I decree upon your life, and listen very carefully, that the oil that has been stolen from your head, Mapaka Rida Nikayabo Shanta Riba Kantia, the oil that was stolen from your head, from your mother's womb, the oil that was stolen from your head when you were a baby, the oil that was stolen from your head as an adult, the oil that was stolen from your head by unfriendly friends, the oil that was stolen from your head by the domestic witchcraft of your father's house, the oil that was stolen from your head by envious witchcraft, right there where you are, with a very loud amen, repossess the oil now. Repossess it, 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 in the name of Jesus. Get yourself ready. I'm going to count 1, 2, 3. You smite that head now, so that the fullness of the oil that was stolen can be restored. 1. Smite that head. 1, 2, 3. I decree upon your life now that the wicked finger pointed against your destiny shall wither. In the name of Jesus. Shall wither. In the name of Jesus. The God of Elijah shall divide your Jordan. 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 In the name of Jesus. Silence. Silence. Something is about to happen to 3 sisters. They may not be able to stand on their feet, but it does not matter. The stone, that familiar spirit, stone, that witchcraft powers, stone, that occultic men have planted in your womb, right there where you are now, I command a volcanic eruption of the power of God into that womb. Let that stone be dissolved now. In the name of Jesus. That's the first person. That's the second person. That's the third person. Yes. 2 more. by someone else. This word is for you. Those voices that have been rising up against your celebration, I command them to shut up now in the name of Jesus. Masikatenda. Let them be silenced. 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 In the name of Jesus. Those powers behind your strange battles, your strange struggles. Strange battles, strange struggles. As I count seven from here, wherever those stubborn powers are, they shall die. The powers that are behind your strange battles, strange warfare, strange struggles. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, whatever they are. As a young man in this service, you have made a great mistake. You took part in raping somebody, but you did not know that the person you raped was actually a witch. Your destiny has been completely deflated. You, that young man, immediately we close. Find a way to the back here so that we can teach you what to do. But right now, you are practically a living corpse, except you confess, repent, and you go through a spiritual program. Everybody will shout this prayer loud and clear, louder than anyone here. Powers! Shooting at the eagle of my life. And your voice roar like thunder. You are a liar. Death! In the name of Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. In Jesus' name we pray. In louder amen. In louder amen. Obviously, God bless you. This morning, inside the school on Sunday, we're looking at what I call the silent spiritual killer. The silent spiritual killer. The silent spiritual killer. There is a silent killer of spiritual life that has killed so many spiritual lives. There is a silent spiritual killer that has converted many eagles to chickens. There is a silent spiritual killer that has converted prophets to parrots. There is a silent spiritual killer that has converted many pastors to pastors. There is a silent spiritual killer that has closed down the open heavens of many. There is a silent spiritual killer which works just like the disease doctors call hypertension. A man may show no symptoms that he's sick. All of a sudden, it goes into paralysis and stroke. It's a silent killer right inside the body, and the person does not know. There is a silent spiritual killer that has tied the spiritual hands of many so they cannot box the spiritual warfare. There is a silent spiritual killer that has with evil cleverness meander its way into so many lives. This killer has wreaked havoc. It is against this killer we have to war this morning. Just as the disease called hypertension does not warn anybody before causing havoc, the same thing with this silent killer. Unfortunately, many are already infected with this disease. And unless they deal with it, it will deal with them. It has already dealt with many. Listen, beloved. This is a morning of divine surgery. What we need in the church now is not cosmeticians. What we need is surgeons. Surgeons. Surgeons like John the Baptist, who said the axe is laid to the root of trees. It's a morning of spiritual surgery. A morning to cry to God. Now, anything in my life that stinks to God, anything in my life that scares God away, anything in my life that makes heaven to say, we don't want this one, anything in my life that makes heaven to declare my position vacant, that God should take it out this morning. That anything around me, consciously or unconsciously, that will scare the move of the Holy Spirit away from my life, it is this morning you should cry for God to reveal it to you so that you can deal with it. This is a personal matter. Not looking at somebody, it's a person, it's that person. No. Point the finger at yourself now. These things that we're talking about, there are things that sometimes cannot be publicly discussed. But you know it. You know it yourself. There are things that many of us don't want others to hear about. It's a serious matter. Things that are strange. Some are so shameful that people don't want to discuss it. But it's hindering the Holy Ghost from working in our lives. You need to cry out for God to reveal to you. And this is a very, very serious matter. And this is why we're gathered here this morning. What is this silent killer that has destroyed many? In the book of Revelation, chapter 3, I read from verse 14. Revelation chapter 3, from verse 14. I am praying for somebody here that the enemy will not waste your life in the name of Jesus. Revelation chapter 3. Verse 14. And unto the angel of the church of the Laodiceans write, this thing saith the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the beginning of the creation of God. I know thy works, that thou art neither cold nor hot. I would that thou wert cold or hot. So then, because thou art lukewarm and neither cold nor hot, I will spew thee out of my mouth. Because thou art lukewarm and neither cold nor hot, I will spew thee. This silent killer is what the Bible calls lukewarmness. 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 Unsaved people who think, talk, look like they are saved is a lie. They are just being lukewarm. Lukewarmness is when you are not saved and you are pretending to be saved. Lukewarmness is false conversion like Judas that followed Jesus. Lukewarmness is when, as a Christian, you are not on fire for God. Lukewarmness is when your whole love for Christ is lost. Lukewarmness is when the good, beautiful vision you see in the past has now disappeared. Lukewarmness is when you are now compromising with the world. Lukewarmness is when you have one foot in the world and one foot in the church. One foot in the world, one foot in God's word. Lukewarmness is when you are a false born-again Christian. Lukewarmness is when you can no longer resist Satan. Satan is just doing what he wants. Lukewarmness is when you no longer obey God's word. you now love pleasure more than God. Lukewarmness is when conviction, passion is dead. He said, I would rather prefer that you be hot or cold. If you are hot, then you are a good example of somebody to follow. So it's okay. If you are cold, you are a good example of somebody not to follow. So that's okay. But when you are not hot, you are not cold, then you get into serious trouble. The Almighty vomits you. He spits you out of his mouth. And once God has vomited a man or a woman out of the mouth, then you are no longer saved. You are just coming to church. You are not saved. Because he has vomited you out. This is why we need to cry to the Lord today. Some have been vomited already. Some have already moved to the mouth, about to be thrown out. Some are already coming out of God's intestine for God to throw them out. It is a good prayer to pray. My Father, don't vomit me. Don't vomit me. Whatsoever will make you to vomit me, take it out of my life now, so that I will not be vomited by heaven. Vomited Christians are not saved. They may be destroyed at any time. Anything can happen to them. Witches can hit them up. Wizards can destroy them. Because they have been vomited. I'm praying for anyone here who has already been vomited. May you receive deliverance this morning in the name of Jesus. Lukewarmness is when you only pray when you're in trouble. Lukewarmness is when you are amongst unbelievers, you talk like them. When you are amongst Christians, you talk like them. Lukewarmness is when somebody is misquoting the Bible and you don't know. You don't know. Somebody says, let's go to the book of Daniel, chapter 30. And you're not able to say, no. No. Daniel is not up to 30 chapters. That's lukewarmness. Lukewarmness is when we say, let's go to the book of Nehemiah. And you are checking the index in your Bible. It should not take a believer more than 1 minute to find anywhere in the Bible. When you open your Bible to the center, you should be able to know whether you are going to the left or to the right when you are looking for something. When you are not able to do that one, it means the fire we are talking about, a mantle of fire. Fire in the bones. There is no fire inside your bones. We shouldn't deceive you. And don't deceive yourself. Lukewarmness is when you cannot pray in the spirit. You can't pray in tongues for 30 minutes, 1 hour, 2 hours. No. When you are coming to church like that, you are comfortable that you cannot pray in tongues. You are comfortable like that. Lukewarmness is when you are more concerned about your outward appearance than how you appear inside to God. Lukewarmness is when you do not understand that Jesus died so that you can make heaven, not he died so that you can just make money. Lukewarmness is when you, as a parent, and you see your children becoming very serious with Jesus, they begin to get jittery. Just like some parents here, who are giving our youth church serious headache. When God grabs some of their children and begins to rebrand their lives, and the lady throws away the lipstick, throws away the jewelry, throws away the dangerous skirt. Some parents who are here, they will be the one complaining again. Say, I am serious, but I don't want you to be serious like that. That's lukewarmness. Serious lukewarmness. Lukewarmness is when you spend more time on Facebook, internet, all those things than the Lord your God. Lukewarmness. Let me explain this so you know how to pray. Lukewarmness means that as you are here now, anywhere you are, whether you are Igbo or Ijoro, any of the children, that in the last 1 year, you did not share the gospel with anybody. You just say, you offer Christ to them. You have not shared the gospel or tried to witness to anyone within 1 year. You have an opportunity of talking to some people that is difficult to reach, but you do not talk to them about Christ. Lukewarmness is when you are always having the world in your mind. You think more about this earth than about heaven. Lukewarmness is when all the offering you bring to God, they are leftovers. That you eat your food, whatever remains, give it to God. That's what you are giving to God. Being stingy towards God is lukewarmness. Do you know that there are people who come here, first food offering, they don't pay. Tithes, they don't pay. They are just coming to pray. Nothing, they do nothing. And when the enemy starts warfare, they begin to harass all the pastors and worry them. They are lukewarm towards God. One way we can know the gauge and the barometer of your love for God is your giving. Lukewarmness is when you only seek God when you are in trouble. Lukewarmness is when you are claiming God is my rock and my salvation, but you do not really trust Him. Lukewarmness is when your Christianity is just trying to please men. They're just doing to please men. You're a man pleaser. And somebody has said one of the greatest signs of failure is to try to please everybody. You cannot please everybody. Jesus said, woe unto you when they say you are good. Lukewarmness is to be claimed, I know my God. You are claiming you know God. But you don't strive to know Him better. The way you were last year is where you are still now. The Bible you are reading last year is what you are reading now. The revelation of last year is still the revelation you carry now. That is lukewarmness. Lukewarmness is when you come to church, you are comparing yourself to others. Anytime they say something is wrong, but I see that person doing the same thing. But that one is doing the same thing. But I think I'm better than that one. The Bible says, comparing thyself by themselves, you are not wise. Lukewarmness is when your life is not really different from the life of those who are in the world. This is spiritual lukewarmness. We are decided the mantle of fire. But come watch me. It's a church that practices holiness within and without. We will not allow Jezebel kind of dresses into this sanctuary. It is not compulsory to come to the mountain of fire. If you don't find what will do comfortable, of course, there are many places you can go. You don't come here wearing dirty skirts. Now you call yourself a child of God. Don't come here with breath that exposes your body. We are not here to admire your body, we are here to worship God. We made it even easier. And if you're a visitor, you're wearing a terrible skirt, we offer you a wrapper. Use this wrapper. Don't come here dressing like this again. Do you know some people say, come back with the same kind of skirt that you condemn? And when they get to the door, say, I know you will not allow me to enter. Give me a wrapper. Give me a wrapper. Those ones are lukewarm Christians. Sometimes agents on assignment. Is lukewarmness. You come to a place and we say, sorry, the way you are dressed now, we don't allow it here. When you are coming again, you will dress properly. And this is very strange. It's only in Christianity that people practice all kinds of indiscipline. Just do what they want. What they could not do in other places, they do. The other time I showed you a video female, or a picture of the son of the Queen of England and the wife, they went to a mosque or a temple. In the place you have to cover your head, you have to remove your shoes, they had to remove it. They had to cover up. They did it. But why is it so difficult? When it comes to the things of God, it is this disease, lukewarmness. There is no fire in their bones. They have beauty in their face. They have shape, they have long legs. They can catwalk. They have big chests where they put chain. But there is no fire. And when the aces are down and all the cards are down and the battle line is drawn, you will discover to your amazement that your lipstick will be useless, your chain will be ineffective. In fact, it's your short skirt, the spirit husband will pull you away. This is the situation. When a person is lukewarm, your life is not really different from those people in the world. If, for example, this money now, if it's the kind of thing that one can do, I say, okay, lock up all the doors here. Everybody here, bring out your phone. I'll begin to look at the kind of pictures that are there. Inside those phones, you will be embarrassed to see what is on some people's phone. They are just coming to church. They are lukewarm. There are lukewarm pastors. There are lukewarm church members. There are lukewarm ministers. There are lukewarm workers in the house of God. When a person is lukewarm, you just want to know enough of Christ to prosper, to make money, to be rich, but you do not want to know Christ that says you must conform to my image. Conform to my image. When there is lukewarmness. There are people here this morning who really need to seriously cry to God. Serious cry. And you will know the reason very soon. When somebody is lukewarm, you prefer to give money as a show than to secretly give, like God says. You prefer. Like the general of myself stands here, I need 10 people who can give 2 million naira. And within 7 days, everyone shall give them triple more. Prefer to march to the front and be recognized than give secretly. It is lukewarmness. You are not hot, you are not cold. Lukewarm people, they love to hear the stories of ancient people in faith. They want to hear about the story of those olden days apostles. They love hearing about our ancient fathers in the Lord who moved mountains for Jesus. But they are not ready to do anything radical to their own lives to become an example of God. I'm praying for somebody else. Whatever God will need to do in your life to make you a divine champion, I pray that He will do it in your life this morning. In the name of Jesus, if there is one problem that Christians have that has reduced our effectiveness, that has doused our power, that has made God to sometimes look as if He has no power, is lukewarmness. He says, if you are hot, fine. You are cold, fine. But neither hot nor cold. Neither hot nor cold. So if you are like that, I will vomit you. Are you the kind of Christian who is making Jesus to want to vomit? Are you the kind of Christian who is actually making God sick? Making God sick? Making Him to want to be vomiting? This is a terrible thought. People who claim to follow Jesus and they are making Jesus sick. It is lukewarmness that causes it. We as believers, and listen to this deep secret, we're supposed to be a living sacrifice. A living sacrifice. What things do you vomit? What things do you vomit? People generally vomit what is not digested. If food has been digested and has been absorbed into the body, it cannot be vomited again. Because when you chew food in your mouth and it enters into your intestine, your intestine grinds it. In the process of digestion, the food is absorbed into your body. Once the food is absorbed into your body, it can no longer be vomited. But if it is not absorbed into the body, if it is not digested, then it can be vomited. Committed people are those who refuse to be digested by the Lord Jesus Christ. They refuse to be digested. If you take a cow, you cannot swallow a cow. But by the time they kill that cow and it's converted to beef, you put the beef in your mouth. You chew the beef. You digest the beef. You digest the beef. That cow that you saw in the market before, that is now dead, has become part of you. It was a living cow before, and because it's been slaughtered now, you eat the meat, and then you digest it. It enters into your body. Then part of that cow is already inside your body. The same thing. Digestion means getting lost. It's lost. That cow that was standing there, that was converted to beef, that you ate and you digest, is lost. Lost into your body. It can never become that cow again. It's been absorbed into your system. If you eat yam, you don't find that yam again once it's been digested. Are you following what I'm saying? So when you are digested in the intense time of the Lord Jesus Christ, you are digested in the intense time of the Lord Jesus Christ, you are finished. Your life ends. You are transformed into the likeness of Jesus. Look at it this way. A piece of meat arrives in the stomach. The chemicals that want to dissolve the food grease the meat. Say, meat, you are welcome. Say, we have come to dissolve it so that you can be transformed into Daniel Olukoya. The meat arrives in the mouth. The chemicals will greet him. Say, welcome. We are here to dissolve you so that you can be transformed. Transformed into Daniel Olukoya. And the meat says, I don't want to be digested. I want to remain as meat. I don't want to lose my identity. I still want to become the cow that I was. And the meat begins to fight the chemical. And the meat won. Very soon, that meat will be vomited. Can't be digested. It's vomited. So, in order for you to depart from the universe of lukewarmness, we must lose everything and be lost in the Lord Jesus Christ. This is a very serious matter, and I want you to understand this. Right there where you are now, I'd like you to raise up your right hand with your eyes closed and shout this loud and clear. Powers challenging my spiritual life. In the name of Jesus. Jesus' name we pray. Listen carefully, beloved. Demons, they know immediately they see you whether you are born again or you are not born again. They know immediately they see you whether you are on fire for God or you are on smoke or you are on ice water. They know. They know very well. Demons, they know whether your names are written in God's book of life or not. They know very well. Demons, they know who have the seal of God on their forehead. They know who to respect. They know they should not show any respect. Demons, they know who they can harm and who they cannot harm. Demons, they know who keep their properties in their house. Like your jewelries, your makeup, you put in your car, they know they are there. They know that the reason the scalp of your head is so tight is because you have attached things you should not attach. They know. Demons, they know. Those who are on their way to hellfire and those who are on their way to heaven. Demons, they know those who are lukewarm. They know those who are just walking about, but they are babies in adult clothing. Demons, they know the so-called adult Christian, but spiritually they are in diapers. Demons, they know those. They can use their bodies to carry out witchcraft meetings. They know. Demons, they know those who have approached them for help before. They know the true ministers. They know the fake ones. They know those who have authority over them. If you are lukewarm, you will not be recognized in hellfire. You will not be recognized in heaven. You will be shot from the two sides. Because you are neither here nor there. Another here, not there. Don't belong to this one, don't belong to this one. You become like that ancient story they used to tell us in primary school about the bats. That there was war between animals and birds. And the bat came into the war front. Anytime the animals were winning, the bat would say, I'm an animal. Anytime the birds were winning, the bat would say, I'm a bird. And the battle went on and on. The bat now made a mistake. He turned his chest to the birds, turned his wing area to the animals. The animals saw the wings. This is a bird. The bird saw the chest. This is an animal. So they shot him from the two sides because he was lukewarm. If he had belonged to one party, perhaps he would have lived longer. There are many bats like that in the house of God. Spiritual bats, they commit sin willfully. And listen, the consequences of sins are suffered more by God than by anyone does. Sin grieves the heart of God. Sin crucifies the Lord Jesus Christ a second time. Sin is persecuting the Lord Jesus Christ. Sin is resisting the Holy Spirit. Sin, called S-I-N, means success in nothing. When you sin, you quench the fire of the Holy Spirit. And a sinner is attempting to overthrow the Lord God from the place of supremacy. It therefore does not matter whether the sin is in motive, in thoughts, in imagination, in look, in touch, in words. You are doing a lot of harm to your Creator. You are doing a lot of harm to your Creator. Willful sin does a lot of damage to the sinner. This is a very serious matter. All the wives who are here, your sins will damage your husband unless you repent. All the husbands who are here, your sins will damage your wife if you don't repent. Someone has said, a bad wife pulls a husband down. A bad wife pulls a husband down. A neutral wife leaves the husband where the husband is. A good wife promotes the husband. If you succeed 1,000 times with a bad wife, you will have succeeded 1 million times or 1 billion times with a good wife. Same way, a bad husband is a hired assassin against a wife. And a bad husband will shorten the life of the woman and kill her very quickly. In fact, the greatest assassin of women is not armed robbers. It's not sickness. It's bad marriage. Many women will still have remained alive if not for the wicked marriage they entered into. Deliberate sin in whatsoever form will make God to vomit you. Deliberate sin is dangerous. Deliberate sin is saying you love the devil. You are glorifying the devil. Ask yourself questions before we start praying. Have I cheated anybody in any way? Have I even cheated the government in any way? Have I ever been paid money more than I ought to have been, more than I ought to have received, and I kept quiet? Have I cheated my bankers in any way? Have I cheated my employers in any way? Did I steal money, equipment, various utilities from my employers? That spoon in your house, was it stolen from a hotel or somewhere? Definitely, if you are eating with a stolen spoon, you will have so much trouble. Have I made false claim or exaggerate or inflate figures? Have I ever claimed money for work I did not do? Did I close my eyes while someone else stole from my employers? Do I exaggerate the weakness of my boss or leader? I exaggerate his weakness outside, but I pretend to be loyal to him? Do I exploit others in any way? Have I ever stolen from a shop? Did I promise somebody something and decided not to let him have it, pretending to have forgotten? Do I borrow things from people and decide not to pay back? Did someone give me something to keep for him, and because he forgot, I kept it to myself? Am I a marketer? Do I mix good and bad articles together for sale? I put the good ones on top and the bad ones below. Did I leave a rented apartment without paying the rent? Did someone send me to buy things and I refused to return the change? I kept the change. Did I abuse the use of telephone, electricity, or equipment of someone else because I'm not paying the bill? Are you here? Did you falsify your age to get the admission or to get obtain a job? Are you the kind you promised marriage to A, marriage to B, marriage to C? Eventually, you broke all those. You broke their heart by breaking the relationship. Are you here this morning? Have you ever made a girl pregnant then denied under the pretext that you were not sure that you are the owner? Did I refuse to tell my husband the blunt truth about my past? Do you smile at people but you internally hate them? Do you have children outside but you have cleverly concealed this information from your wife? You want her to have the shock of her life at your burial ground. Have you ever stolen anything from a hotel or office? Are you the kind of people who pick money from the ground and spend it? This is a very serious matter. A question you must ask ourselves so that God will not vomit you, so that heaven will not regard you as a lukewarm believer. Part of the motto of MFM is fire in the bowls. Fire inside the bowls. And once that fire is in your bones, you can't help it, you will evangelize. If that fire is in your bones, you can't help it, you will prophesy. If that fire is in your bones, you can't just sit there quietly and you are not telling others about Christ. If that fire is in your bones, there are certain things you become uncomfortable with and you begin to harass them in the name of the Lord. I'm believing God that there will be somebody here today who will say, I have been cold for too long. I want fire. I want the kind of fire that came upon the apostles. And when they arrested them, and they whipped them, as they were whipping them with koboko, with us whip, fear, fear, fear. The Bible says they were smiling. They were happy. Said, praise the Lord. We are counted worthy of suffering for Jesus. Praise the Lord. See, they were rejoicing that they were being beaten for Christ's sake. Beaten, and they were rejoicing. It's in our present Christianity. Somebody will say, they got me upset. I'm upset. Upset. They upset me. They walk out of church. I'm upset. I'm not coming again. They whip those men, and they were smiling. Say, thank God we suffered for his sake. Rise to your feet, man. Rise to your feet.
It is no longer I that liveth, but Christ that liveth in me. It is no longer I that liveth, but Christ that liveth in me. Jesus is alive in me. He is no longer I that liveth, but Christ that liveth in me. It is no longer I that liveth, but Christ that liveth in me. It is no longer I that liveth, but Christ that liveth in me, in me, in me, in me. Jesus is alive in me. It is no longer I that liveth, but Christ that liveth in me.
Right there where you are this morning, begin to talk to the Lord. That, Father, anything you need to do in my life that will make me to be a delight of heaven, anything that stings your nostrils, take it away from my life. Whatever you need to do to make me a delight of heaven, do it now. Let me not go home the same way I came to this place. Let fire enter into my bones. Talk to the Lord.
You've been to Jesus for the cleansing power. Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you truly in this place, this heart? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood? In a soul, cleansing blood of the Lamb. Are your garments washed totally white? The soul washed. Have you been to Jesus for the cleansing power? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Do you trust in Jesus who was crucified? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments washed totally white? The soul, are you washed the blood of the Lamb? How well we measure, we measure that we talk to our home. I'm sure that our food will see more love, love. Well, we measure. Umba o lu bala ni lo jo jumo ka fomo na je da bu to o agbe ke mi eni da ko mo ki awe o na je da bu to awe o ni na je. Me a gel that would talk to a call. I'm sure that I'll prove who is my love, love. I will be a gel that would talk.
Amen. As many as are here this morning and they want the words that Jeremiah spoke to happen in their lives, Jeremiah said his word were like fire in my bones. You want that fire to enter into your bones? There is no way that fire will enter into your bones that you will remain the same. Those who see you will know something has changed here. Something has changed here. With a voice that roars like thunder, you will cry on that fire. It's a simple but effective prayer. Holy Ghost, fire! Enter into my bones. Can I hear you saying it? Can I hear the sisters shouting it? Is that the best the sisters can do here today? Brothers, let me hear you roaring like thunder. By the time you will have said that 10 times, things will have started happening to your life. Provided you are saying it from your heart, and you are concentrating, and you are serious. Open your mouth and pray like that. Masopoli katela kaya boshandara basanda. Ribo pachita tala kaya boshanda. Mana ribo soponde kaya boshente rabasanta. Mapiali katela raba. Something must happen in your life today.
I will give God my life. My lifetime. I will give God my life. If I give God my lifetime, if I give God my life, He will take care of me. He will. He will never let you down. Lord, I give you my lifetime. Lord, I give you my life. Can you sing it again loud and clear? My lifetime. My life. Lord, I give you my lifetime. My life. Lord, I give you. You will take care of me. You will never, never let me down. You will never, never let me down.
Seven prayers to pray. Few minutes to pray them. But I assure you that as far as you concentrate and focus your attention on heaven, you will have a divine visitation. Jesus said to his disciples, "But you shall receive power after the Holy Ghost has come upon you." We are going to ask for 7 different powers. 7 different powers. And pray it from your heart. Especially if you love your destiny. Power! Is that the loudest you can shout it? Is that the loudest you can shout it? Shout it. To have recognition in heaven. Fall upon me now. In the name of Jesus. Heavenly recognition. The power of heavenly recognition. Power of heavenly recognition. Fall upon me now. In Jesus' name we pray. This second power, ask for it very well. Power for my eagle to fly. Come upon me now. In the name of Jesus. Open your mouth and ask for that power too. For my eagle to fly. Fall upon me now. Masikaya Boshenta. In Jesus' name we pray. This third power, make sure nobody's voice is louder than yours. Power! Against unclean spirits. Fall upon me now. In the name of Jesus. Power against unclean spirits. In Jesus' name we pray. Of resurrection, fall upon me now. In the name of Jesus. Jesus, then we pray. Power to please God. Fall upon me now. In the name of Jesus. Power to please God. Fall upon me now. In Jesus' name we pray. Two more. Power to destroy my weaknesses. Fall upon me now. In the name of Jesus. Power to destroy my weaknesses. Fall upon me now. In the name of Jesus. In Jesus' name we pray. Now, finally, with a voice that has no respect for the devil. Can you shout this loud?
Power! To pursue my pursuers! Fall upon me now!
Amen. Sing this song louder than anyone around you. Sing it 7 times. Just 7 odd times. And then the service closes. But on the 7th time, the power of God will fall upon this place. And a lot of destinies will be repaired. But make sure that nobody's voice is louder than yours. Thank you, Jesus.
I want the fire that is fresh. I want the fire that is fresh. Oh, fire cannot do. I want the fire that is fresh.
I want the fire that is fresh.
That is fresh.
I want the fire that is fresh.
Oh, yes, sir.
Oh, fire cannot do. I want the fire that is
number two now.
I want the fire that is fresh. I want the fire that is fresh. Oh, fire cannot do. I want the fire.
Number three now.
I want the fire that is fresh. I want the fire that is fresh. Oh, fire cannot do. I want the fire that is fresh.
Number four now.
I want the fire that is fresh. I want the fire that is fresh. Oh, fire cannot do. I want the fire.
Number five now.
I want the fire.
My body is a fire.
I want the fire that is fresh. Oh, fire cannot do.
Yes, sir.
I want the fire.
Number six now.
I want the fire that is fresh. I want the fire that is fresh. Oh, fire cannot do. I want the fire.
Number seven now.
I want the fire that is fresh. I want the fire that is fresh. I want the fire that is fresh. I want the fire that is fresh.
Yes! Yes! Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Father, continue to lay your hands upon us. We commit this particular week unto your holy hands. Let there be divine intervention. Let your power take absolute control. Cover your people with the blood of Jesus. All the prayer requests, O Lord, answer them by fire. The Lord blesses you from Zion. Make his face to shine upon you. In Jesus' mighty name we pray.
Thanks for watching. Remember to click the subscribe button and the notification bell beside it to be updated with Ebenezer Meek channel's video whenever available. Don't forget to comment, like, and share the video with your friends and family. Bye.